which will be after this. More than ever before in human history, we share a common destiny. We can master it only if we face it together. Respected Provincial Reverend Brother Jacob Grises, Educational Convener Brother Shajan Anthony, our Principal Reverend Dr. Brother Anthony Reddy, our Vice Principal Brother Kumar Chandra, Principal, teachers, and dear students of Mount Koshin institutions, dear principals, teachers, and students of various concerned schools, and dear parents and students of our school. Good morning and a warm welcome to Model United Nations Conference. It's my privilege to welcome you all to the first virtual Model United Nations Conference hosted by our school. A Model United Nations trains today's students to tomorrow's leaders. Sounds students good. Who do Model United Nations would be one day change the world if there is one section of the society that feels discriminated, if it is not justice. Model United Nations means as an expression of stimulation and academic activity in which students can learn and foster negotiation, speaking, and communication skills. In addition, students can learn about international relations and working with United organizations. Crisis committees, unlike the students who deal with the crisis scenarios in which can be contemporary or historical, can develop leadership skills.
Thank you.
Please take your seats. Now I request
As a leader member of this institution, it is a great pride, a tremendous sense of honor that I open the Modern United Nations Conference organized by Mumford School, Sangli, Maharashtra. In its ninth year, Modern United Nations has become a symbol of Mumford School for what we believe is right about today and what we hope for tomorrow. Those supported me.
Small degree by others, receiving was envisioned, will be carried on by Mumford students every year. Our teachers and students have worked very hard to ensure an excellent conference for all delegates. And I am confident that this is what you'll experience for the next couple of hours. At its core, then this conference is not just about Modern United Nations, but about the immense capacity of youth. More specifically, it's a clear demonstration of the transformative power of the Mumford students. Dear teachers, thank you for the great work you have done to prepare for this day. You make this school proud. Dear delegates, as you participate in this conference, I encourage you to take the work you do seriously and do it to the best of your ability. Do the work with a sense of honor and humility. A thinker and writer named David Matten recently captured this idea by stating, "We can make things better, but only if we go forward with our eyes open. We have seen amazing progress in almost every dimension of human affairs across the last century, but that progress is fragile. We need to be its constant and vigilant guards. Though not a perfect institution, the United Nations for over 7 decades has been a constant and vigilant guard of progress, peace, and security. Born from the ashes of World War II, not as an utopian idea, the UN, while recognizing human imperfection and the attendant dangers of misunderstandings in the international relations, also realizes the importance of dialogue, the need for cooperation, the necessity of collective action. Today, at this conference, you model those values and that fundamental work. As you do so, I hope that you keep in mind the fragility of our progress as species and therefore do your work as delegates with the skill, tenacity, humility, and passion. Dr. Martin Luther King said The arc of the moral universe is long, but it bends towards justice. That may be true, but the arc doesn't bend on its own. To move to a future with more justice, more peace, and more prosperity, talented, thoughtful people must commit to engage in the great struggle to craft a better world and a brighter future. Delegates, today as you model the work done by the United Nations, in some small way, you take up that struggle. Today, you are the vigilant guards. Thank you for joining us at the first Model United Nations Conference by Mumford School, Savlivi. We are honored to have you all here. Wish you all fruitful time. God bless us all. Thank you.
Thank you, brother, for opening this conference. Now we will begin with the proceedings of Model United Nations Conference. Now I request Ms. Pranil Reddy to take over the session.
Good morning, the Secretary General, Deputy Speaker, Chairperson, and the delegates. I welcome all of you to the Model United Nations Conference. Now I request Secretary General of United Nations to speak about the structure of Model United Nations.
Good morning. As Secretary of the Chairperson, infused with immense pleasure to execute this international forum to the delegates gathered here and this all gallery. The United Nations is an international organization founded in 1945 after the Second World War by 51 countries committed to maintain international peace and security, developing friendly relations among nations, promoting social progress, better living standards, and human rights. Now, more than 75 years later, the United Nations is still working to maintain international peace and security, give humanitarian assistance to those in need, protect human rights, and uphold international law. The United Nations has set sustainable development goals for 2030 in order to maintain, achieve a better and more sustainable future for all of us. UN member states have also agreed to climate actions to limit global warming. With many achievements, now in its past, the United Nations is still working to maintain and achieve. While the existence of Model United Nations can be tracked back to the US in 1949. In India, they started gaining popularity in 1996 and since then have been conducted on a regular basis at international and national levels. United Nations Information Center, New Delhi, collaborates with nearly 50 Model United Nations conferences per year in India, organized by schools and universities. The first recorded instance of a Model United Nations conference was at Swarthmore College on April 5, 1947. Over 150 students from over 41 colleges were reported as participating. The delegates simulated a general assembly and recommended that member states establish an international control and development of atomic energy, conclude a treaty on disarmament, that the UN adopt a uniform citizenship of refugees, that the UN amend the Charter to adopt a definition of aggregation, and that nations promote the reconstruction of devastated areas through economic assistance through the UN. General Assembly organs like the United Nations Social, Humanitarian, Cultural Committee, to regional supranational bodies like the European Union, to cabinets, corporate boards, and more. Delegates from around the country, around the world, travel to participate in the Model United Nations Conference where they simulate one of dozens of committees and work with one another to solve the major problems of the world. Why do we need Model United Nations? Model United Nations offers an unparalleled chance to develop skills in public speaking, international relations, and diplomacy. Delegates from around the world travel to participate in the conferences like the MUNUC, making this great place to meet new people and make new friends. For students interested in pursuing politics or international relations, simulating international or national bodies offer valuable insight into the decision-making process of top leaders. Delegates conduct research before conference. They must formulate position papers and create policies that they will debate with other delegates in their committee. At the end of the conference, delegates will vote on a written policies called draft resolutions with the goal of passing them with a majority vote. The best performing delegates in each committee as well as delegations are sometimes recognized as awards. Participating in Model United Nations is meant to foster negotiations, speaking and communication skills in students. In addition, crisis committees, unlike the students who deal with crisis scenarios, which can be contemporary or historical, can develop leadership skills and the ability to adapt and deal with unexpected situations. Delegates of each committee are often expected to pre-formulate the position of the country or group they represent. Based on these background guides, and submit the results of this preparation to their committee in the form of a position paper. The purpose of writing a position paper for a student is to familiarize delegates with the substantial topics to debate, encourage academic research and writing, and to enable the students in substantial preparation for conferences. Thank you.
Thank you, Madam Secretary. Now I request Deputy Speaker to speak about the importance of participating in Model United Nations.
Good morning to all. I would like to explain the benefits of the Model United Nations. Model United Nations is an educational simulation where students can learn about diplomacy, international relations, and the United Nations. At a Model United Nations conference, students work as a representative of a country, organization, or a person and must work with other delegates from around the world. Model United Nations teaches participants research, speaking, debating, and writing skills, in addition to critical thinking, teamwork, and leadership abilities. Usually, an extracurricular activity, some schools offer a Model United Nations as a class. It is meant to engage students and allow them to develop understanding into current world issues. A Model United Nations is a simulation of an actual United Nations conference where students are tasked with solving a global issue through research, drafting, lobbying, and debate to pass a suitable resolution. Students take on the roles of delegates, speakers, and chairs, representing different countries and work with other delegates from around different backgrounds to take part in discussions and reach a solution for the agenda they are assigned. In Model United Nations, students will be able to build their confidence, analytical skills, problem-solving skills, diplomacy, and developing efficient public speaking skills takes practice. And the Model United Nations provide an ideal platform where the students can explore and improve their capabilities. Attending a Model United Nations is an ideal way to network, make new friends, and build connections that will come in handy later on. During a Model United Nations, you will meet other delegates. Considering all the benefits listed above, it is not a stretch to claim that students' personality will flourish at Model United Nations. The independence, challenges, and teamwork will surely help to enhance the students' leadership.
it will expand students' knowledge about global issues because modern United Nations obligates every participant to understand the global issue and their opinion may contribute to solve the problems that impact our planet today. Modern United Nations conferences are diplomatic simulations.
At the fundamentals of the debate, Modern United Nations teach you how to be a good diplomat with increase your diplomacy and negotiation skill. There is a section that you have to lobby other participants to agree with your interests. Modern United Nations teaches its participants called delegates researching, public speaking, debating, and writing skills, teamwork, and cultural empathy. Modern United Nations and stands for an educational simulation of diplomatic decision making. The language of the session is English and the dress code formal attire. Thank you.
Thank you.
Madam Deputy Speaker, now I request Madam Chairperson to speak about the President of Modern United Nations.
Good morning. I would like to present the ground rules and concepts of Modern United Nations. The opening of the debate. Number first, roll call. Each session deals with verifying roll call. All the countries in alphabetical order state present or present and voting. Say present and voting if you are voting. Say present if you are not voting. Number two, setting the agenda and motion. In order to put the topic area on the agenda, the motion requires to attend delegate can propose that topic of their concern. The countries are Mongolia, Myanmar, and Zimbabwe. Number three, speakers list. The delegates are given the opportunity to state the stances of their country regarding the particular topic or agenda at discussion. You can talk about what your country has done, is doing at the movement, plans to do with subject under consideration. You can also talk what other countries have done that might affect your country's progress to development. Number four, point of information. When you want to ask a delegate on the flow of question, you raise the point of information and the head table will recognize it. Then you can ask any question as you please, as long as it relates to the topic or what the delegate said. But do keep in mind to keep the point of information short and sweet. Number five, request to follow up. A point that is raised immediately after you ask a question, it essentially means that you have a follow-up question that you would like to ask. Some delegates take this opportunity for a completely different question. However, that is not the case. If you raise a right request to follow up, make sure that your follow-up question is related to the original question that you asked. Number six, right to reply. Used for two purposes. First, if there is an error of facts, if a delegate is wrong, you raise the right to reply to correct that delegate for the benefit of the House. Number two, if a delegate has infringed your country's sovereignty or raised something against your country or your foreign policy. Number seven, point of parliamentary inquiry. This is basically where you have a doubt or question with regard to procedure of the conference or a question with regard to what's going to happen next or what will happen in the evening, or any question with this regard. Number eight, moderated caucus topic. A topic that is submitted to the House that is of relevance to the main topic that is discussed. It could either be a subtopic or a topic that could contribute the debate and discussion of the main topic that is discussed. Delegates are not allowed to ask point of information. There can only be speeches on the moderated caucus topic submitted. Number nine, unmoderated caucus, where all the delegates sign off a formal break, wherein all the delegates split into different groups and come out with different resolutions, which aligns with their country's foreign policy and foreign interest. This is where resolutions are made, and following this, you move into resolution debate.
Number 10, debate on resolution. Usually you will have two or three solutions that come out and unmoderated caucus. Each resolution is sponsored by a delegate and is co-sponsored by another delegate. What happens is that you have against resolution. It depends on your country's foreign policy and what your country would say in an actual United Nation. Number 11, motion to movement to open this debate to this resolution. Obtain the floor, entertain speeches for and against resolution. Regarding voting resolutions, you can be for, against and absent. It depends on your country's interest and how it aligns with your country's foreign policy. The delegates, while discussing, be confident and polite, be diplomatic and willing to compromise with other countries. Thank you.
Thank you,
Madam Chairperson. Now, we begin our session. Roll call. Mongolia.
Present and voting.
Myanmar.
Present and voting.
Zimbabwe.
Present and voting.
There are 15 delegates here.
5 delegates representing one country each. Are there any points to be noted on speaker's chair?
No, Mr. Speaker.
Is there any motion on speaker's time?
Yes, Mr. Speaker. Mongolia proposed the speaker time can be mostly 10 minutes.
Thank you, delegate. Those who wish to be on speaker's desk, please take your placards. Is there any motion, Zimbabwe?
Yes, Mr. Speaker. The delegates from Myanmar, Mongolia, and Zimbabwe wish to share their concern about the country's motion.
The motion is unanimous. Mongolia, as you are the first to propose the motion, you can begin now. Myanmar and Zimbabwe, you can continue as Mongolia did say. Mongolia, you can begin now.
Welcome to Mongolia. I would like to speak about the geography and demography of Mongolia. Mongolia is the world's 18th largest country after Iran. It is significantly larger than the next largest country, Peru. It mostly lies between the latitudes 41 degree and 52 degree north and longitudes 87 degree and 120 degree east. The geography of Mongolia is varied, with the Gobi Desert to the south and cold and mountainous regions to the north and west. Most of the Mongolia consists of the Mongolian Manchurian grassland steppe, with forested areas accounting for 11.2% of the total land area, a higher percentage than Ireland. The whole of Mongolia is considered to be a part of the Mongolian Plateau. The highest point in Mongolia is the Khuten Peak in the Tavanbog Massif in the far west at 4,374 meters. The basin of the Uvias Lake, shared with the Tava Republic, is a National World Heritage Site. Climate of Mongolia. Mongolia is known as the land of eternal blue sky, or the country of blue sky, because it has over 250 sunny days in a year. Most of the country is hot in summer and extremely cold in the winter, with January temperature topping as low as minus 30 degrees Celsius. A vast front of cold, heavy and shallow air comes in from Siberia in winter and collects from rivers, valleys and low basins, causing very cold temperatures, while the mountains are much warmer due to the effects of temperature inversion. In winter, the Mongolia comes under the influence of the Siberian anticyclone. The localities most severely affected by this cold temperature are the Uvias province, the Western Khovsgol, the Eastern Zarkand province, the Northern Balkan, and the Eastern Donut province. Madam Secretary, our country is subject to occasional harsh climatic conditions known as Dzud. Dzud is a natural disaster unique to Mongolia, which results in large proportions of the country's livestock dying from starvation or freezing temperatures, which results in economic upheaval of the largely pastoral population. Demographics of Mongolia. Mongolia's total population as of January 2015
was estimated by the US Census Bureau to be 3,251,000 people, ranking about 121st in the world.
Madam Secretary, United Nations estimates
resemble those made by the Mongolian National Statistical Office. About 59% of the total population is under the age of 13, and 27% of whom are under the age of 27. This growing population has placed strains on the economy of Mongolia. The first census of the 20th century was carried in 1918 and recorded a population of 647,500 people. Since the end of socialism, our country has experienced a decline of total fertility rate that is steeper than any other country in the world. According to the recent United Nations estimations, in 1970-1975, the fertility was estimated to be 7.33 children per woman, dropping to about 2.1 to 2.4 in 2005. This decline ended, and in 2005 to 2010, the fertility rate was estimated to be 2.5% per woman and stabilized afterwards at the rate of 2.2 to 2.3 children per woman. Languages of Mongolia. Our country, Mongolia, has a official language known as Mongolian, and it's spoken by 95% of the population. There are also some speakers of Mongolic Kamnigan in the country. The variety of dialects of Oyat and Balyat are also spoken across the country. Then in the west of the country, Kazakh and Tawan, both Turkic languages, are also spoken. Mongolian Sign Language is the principal language of the deaf community. Religions in Mongolia. Mongolian shamanism has been widely practiced in Mongolia. Mongolians have gave way to the Tibetan Buddhism, but shamanism has left a mark on Mongolia's religious culture, and it continues to be practiced. The Kazakhs of Western Mongolia, some Mongols, and other Turkic peoples adhere to Islam. Tibetan Buddhism, which had been the religion prior to the rise of communism, again rose to become the most widely practiced religion in Mongolia. Since the end of religious repression in 1990, also allows for the other religions to spread in the country. Thank you.
Madam Secretary, I would like to tell you about social and political status of Mongolia. In terms of administration, Mongol government should regularly appoint regional administrators from desperate places to rule other areas. For example, sending Han Chinese and Han Tang from China to serve as administrators over the Muslim population Bukhara in Central Asia,
and sending Central Asia to serve as administrators in China. This strategy was implemented to curb the power of local people. There are two types of food in Mongolia.
There are two types of food in Mongolia: red food and white food. Their food consists of meat, fish, etc. And white food consists of milk products, dairy products, etc. Red food are the main food source during winter.
In terms of trade in Mongolia, Mongolia had a strong history of supporting traders and merchants. Genghis Khan had encouraged foreign traders and merchants in its career even before uniting Mongolians. The merchants provided him with information of neighboring cultures, served as diplomats and official traders, and were essential for many needed goods, as Mongolia provided a little of their own. In terms of domestic animals in Mongolia, there are five the most important domestic animals in Mongolia. They are camels, horses, cattle, sheep, and goats. They are actually valued for their milk, and their hides are used for clothing and shelter. Even though they are considered unattractive by other cultures, they are well adapted to cold weather and scarcity shortages of food and water. They are still known for living in the very harsh conditions, even though the animals from other cultures perish. in terms of kinship and family in Mongolia. In a traditional Mongolian family, each son became a part of family third as he married, with the elder son becoming more than the younger son. The youngest son will remain in the parental tent caring for his parents, and after their death, he will inherit the parental tent in addition to his own herd. This inheritance system was mandated by the law courts of Yasa, created by Genghis Khan. Likewise, each son inherited a part of family's camping, lands, and pastures, with the elder son becoming more than the younger son. In terms of clothing in Mongolia, color was an important characteristic of Mongolian clothing, as it had symbolic meaning. During large festivities held by Khan, he would give his important diplomats special robes to wear with special color according to what was being celebrated. And if one was caught wearing it at other times, the punishments were very severe, according to the rules during the times of Kublai Khan. In terms of women in Mongolia, compared to other civilizations, Mongolian women had a power to influence society and enjoyed much more freedom in gender. Even though men were dominant in society, many turned to women in their lives for advice. While developing organizations with Mongol Empire, Genghis Khan asked for assistance from his mother. He honored the advice women in his life offered. In terms of dwellings in Mongolia, Mongols have been living virtually in the same dwellings from at least 6th century AD. These dwellings are called Jurs, and during the Mongol Empire, they consisted at a round collapsible wooden frame covered in felt. The roof was formed from about 80 wooden rods attached at one end to the wall frame and at the other to an iron ring in the center, providing a sturdy base for the felt roof. Thank you, Madam Secretary. Madam Secretary, today I would like to represent history and culture of my country, Mongolia. History of Mongolia. Prehistory and antiquity. The Koid Tenska cave in Koid province shows blindly pink, brown, and red ocha paintings, earning it the nickname the last cats of Mongolia. Neolithic agricultural settlements such as those at Norvaland, Thamsak Bulak, Bayanzak, and Russian Khark predated the introduction of horse riding nomadism. Horse riding nomadism have been documented by archaeological evidence in Mongolia during the Copper Bronze Age of Afanasio culture, Middle Ages to the earlier 20th century. In 2006, a Tibetan named Temujin took the title Genghis Khan, and after his death, the Mongol Empire was divided into four kingdoms or Khanates, in which one of the Khanates was the Great Khanate, ruled by Kublai Khan, who was grandson of Genghis Khan. After more than a century of power, the Yun dynasty was replaced by the Ming dynasty in 1368. Modern history and republic. With the fall of the Qing dynasty in 1911, Mongolia under the Boj Khan declared its independence. After, in 1919, the October Revolution in Russia, Chinese troops led by warlord occupied Mongolia. After the death of warlord, Mongolia declared its independence again on July 11. In 1924, Boj Khan died of cancer. And in 1930, the Soviet Union stopped Buryat migration to the Mongolian People's Republic to prevent Mongolian deunification. Cold War and Post-Cold War. The February 1945 Yalta Conference provided the Soviet Union's participation in the Pacific War. After the establishment of the People's Republic of China, both countries confirmed their mutual recognition on October 6, 1949. The fall of the Soviet Union in 1991 strongly influenced Mongolian politics and youth. During this time, China has supported Mongolia's application to the membership in the Asian Pacific Cooperation Dialogue, ACD, Asian Pacific Economic Cooperation, APEC, and of granting its observer status to the Shanghai Cooperation Organization. Culture of Mongolia. Visual arts in Mongolia. Mongolian fine arts were heavily influenced by the religious texts.
In the late 19th century, painters like Marwan Sharaw turned to more realistic paintings. All forms of fine arts flourished after only the perestroika in the late 1980s. Architecture in Mongolia. The traditional Mongolian dwelling was known as Egin. In the past, it was known by the Russian term Yurt. The Mongolian architect used structures with 6 and 12 angles with pyramidal roofs approximately to the round shape of a Egin. Chulten distinguished 3 styles in Mongolian traditional architecture, which were Mongolian, Tibetan, and Chinese. In terms of music in Mongolia, the Mongolian music was strongly influenced by nature, nomadism, shamanism, and Tibetan Buddhism. The traditional Mongolian music used a variety of instruments, famously the Moren Khur, and also singing styles like Yurtian Du. The first rock band of Mongolia was the Soyol Erdemi, founded in 1960s. In media of Mongolia, the Mongolian press began in 1920 with close ties to the Soviet Union under the Mongolian Communist Party. A new law on the press freedom, drafted with the help of international NGOs on August 28, 1998, and it enacted on January 1, 1999. Since 2006, the media environment has been improving with the government debating a new Freedom of Information Act and the removal of affiliation of media outlets with the government. In terms of sports and festivals, the main national festival of Mongolia is Nadam, that consists of 3 main festivals, which are archery, cross-country horse riding, and wrestling. These were the traditionally recognized 3 main games of Nadam. Horse riding is the especially center of the Mongolian culture, and Mongolian wrestling is the most popular of all Mongolian sports. It was the highlight of the 3 main games of Nadam. Thank you.
Madam Secretary, I would like to speak about government and politics in Mongolia. Our country is a semi-presidential republic, democratic republic with a directly elected president. The people also elect the deputies in the National Assembly, the state Great Khural. The president appoints the prime minister and nominates the cabinet on the proposal of prime minister. The constitution of our country guarantees a number of freedom, including full freedom of expression and religion. Mongolia has a number of political parties, and the largest are Mongolian People's Party and the Democratic Party. The non-governmental organization Freedom House considers our country to be free. The People's Party, known as People's Revolutionary Party, between 1924 and 2010 formed the government from 1921 to 1996 in one party system until 1990 and from 2000 to 2004. From 2004 to 2006, it was the part of coalition with the Democrats and 2 other parties. And after 2006, it was the dominant party in 2 other coalitions. Our country uses a unicameral legislature, the state Great Khural, with 76 seats. Foreign relations. Mongolia's foreign relations traditionally focus on its 2 large neighbors, China and Russia. Mongolia is economically dependent on these countries. China receives 90% of Mongolia's exports by value and accounts for 60% of its foreign trade, while Russia supplies 90% of Mongolia's energy requirements. It has begun seeking positive focusing on encouraging foreign investments and trade. Military and legal system. Mongolia supported the 2003 invasion of Iraq and has sent several successive contingents of 103 to 180 troops each in Iraq. About 130 troops are currently deployed in Afghanistan. On November 21, 2005, George Bush became the first ever sitting US president to visit our country. In 2004, under Bulgarian chairmanship, an Organization for Security and Cooperation of Europe. It invited our country as its newest Asian partner. The judiciary of Mongolia is made of three-tiered court system. First instance court is each provincial district and each Ulan Bator. Appellate court for provincial and Ulan Bator capital. And the court of last resort at Supreme Court of Mongolia. For questions of constitutional law, there is a separate constitutional court. A judicial general council nominates judge, which then should be confirmed by the parliament and appointed by the president. Arbitration centers provide alternative dispute resolution option for commercial and other disputes. Administration divisions. Mongolia is divided into 21 provinces and subdivided into 331 districts. The capital Ulan Bator is administrated separately as a capital city with provincial status. Major cities. About 40% of population lives in Ulan Bator. And in 2002, a further 23% lived in Darkhan. The mix centers and some level permanent settlements. Another share of population lives in some centers. Economy. Economic activities in our country has long been based on herding and agriculture. Although development of intensive minerals deposit of copper, coal, tin, gold have emerged as a driver of industrial production. In 2006, 68.4% of Mongolia's exports went to PRC and PRC supplied 29.8% of Mongolia's export. Madam Secretary, for your information, our country ranked as lower middle income economy by World Bank. Some 22.4% of population lives on less than US dollar, 1.25 a day. Mineral industries. Minerals represent more than 80% of Mongolia's export, a proportion expected to eventually rise to 95%. Fiscal revenues from mining represent 21% of government income in 2010 and rose to 24% in 2018. About 3,000 mining licenses have been issued. Mining continues to rise as major industries in Mongolia. Agriculture. In 2002, about 30% of households in Mongolia live for breeding livestock. Most herders in Mongolia follow the pattern of nomadic and semi-nomadic. Madam Secretary, I would like to raise my concern about my country. Due to severe 2009 and 2010 winter, Mongolia lost 9.7 million animals or 22% of livestock. The immediate effect meat prices, which increased twofold. The GDP dropped 1.6 in 2009. Thank you, Madam Secretary.
Any queries, Myanmar and Zimbabwe? Myanmar, you can ask.
Why is Mongolia known as the country of blue sky or the land of eternal blue sky?
Mongolia is known as the country of blue sky or the land of eternal blue sky because it has over 250 sunny days in a year.
Zimbabwe, now you can ask.
What are the dwellings of Mongolia?
The dwellings of Mongolia are called gil, and these have been used from at least 6th century AD.
Thank you, delegate from Mongolia. Next, Myanmar, you can begin now.
Good morning, judges, speaker, deputy speaker, madam secretary, chairperson, and all my dear friends. We belong to Myanmar family. Now I would like to share some information of my country, Myanmar. Myanmar or Burma. The official name of the country is the Republic of Union Myanmar. In 1989, the names were changed from Burma to Myanmar. Both names are derived from a majority ethnic group, the Bamar. Myanmar being the formal literal term, whereas the Burma is a political everyday term. Madam Secretary, the reason this is a contentious issue is because The change was undertaken by an unelected military government without consulting the people. Under today's more subtle representative system, all five cities, National League for Democracy, said that she would use both names. At a speech to foreign ambassadors in April 2016, she said that she would use Myanmar and Burma. The governments such as the US and the UK continue to use Burma, but Myanmar is used in the vast majority on international media. It is used by the UN. And in general, traveling the country, we find that locals also use Myanmar. This is the reason why Myanmar is used on this website. The capital of Myanmar is Naypyidaw. The largest city in Myanmar is Yangon. The official language of Myanmar is Burmese. The official script of Myanmar is Burmese script. The ethnic groups of Myanmar are 68% Burman, 9% Shan, 7% Karen, 4% Rakhine, 3% Chinese, 2% Indian, 2% Mon, and 5% others. The religion of Myanmar are 87.9% Buddhism, 6.2% Christianity, 4.3% Islam, 1.6% others. Thank you, Madam Secretary. Madam Secretary, Myanmar or Burma, officially the Republic of Union of Myanmar, is a country in Southeast Asia. Myanmar is bordered by India and Bangladesh to its northwest, China to its northeast, Laos and Thailand to its east and southeast, the Andaman Sea and Bay of Bengal to its south and southwest. Language in Myanmar. Area and population. Myanmar or Burma is a country that covers 676,578 square kilometers. That is about the size of France and has a population about 52 million. We people are made up of striking era of different ethnic groups, which include Bamar or Burmese, by some distance the largest in number, Shan, Karen, Kachin, Chin, Mon, Han Chinese and Indian, to name but a few. Madam Secretary, language in my country. This variety of ethnicities also mean massive language diversity. Although Burmese is the official language and English is widely used to varying the degree of proficiency. Capital and major cities. Madam Secretary, since 2005, the capital has been located in Naypyidaw, but the formal capital, Yangon or Rangoon, remains the biggest city, commercial center, and arrival point for most visitors. The moving of capital is in fact in line with the tradition of upheaval and renewal in Myanmar. The country has had many capitals over the years, including Mandalay, Imba, Gaokyu, to name just a few. Thank you, Madam Secretary.
Madam Secretary, security of our country, Myanmar. Myanmar's armed forces, which consist of an army, a navy, and an air force, have expanded rapidly, nearly quadrupling in size since the mid-20th century. The army is by far and largest and best equipped of the three branches. And for a number of years, it has borne the chief responsibility for combating armed insurgency within the country, health and welfare of our country. With the majority of population living in rural areas with unreliable infrastructure and transportation, rural healthcare has remained both a challenge and a priority for the Myanmar government. A lack of adequate sanitation, although improving, and an underutilized healthcare system have contributed to relatively high rates of gastrointestinal diseases, tuberculosis, and malaria. Education in our country. Myanmar has a long tradition of educational achievement, and about 9/10 of the population is literate. 5 years of primary education, beginning at age 5, is compulsory in some remote rural areas. However, formal schooling may not be available. Secondary education consists of a 4-year cycle followed by a 2-year cycle. Languages in Myanmar. Many indigenous languages, as distinct from Mon dialects, are spoken in Myanmar. The official language is Burmese, spoken by the people of plains and as a second language by most people of the hills. During the colonial period, English became the official language, but Burmese continued to be the primary language in all other settings. Economy of Myanmar. Myanmar's economy is based on the kyat. The national currency is one of the least developed of the region and is basically agricultural. Much of the population is engaged directly in agricultural pursuits. Myanmar also has an extensive informal economy. Agriculture, forestry and fishing in Myanmar. Agriculture, forestry and fishing together constitute the largest contributor to the Myanmar's economy. About half of all agricultural land in Myanmar is devoted to rice and to increase production. The government has promoted multiple cropping system that is easily supported by the country's climate. Thank you, Madam Secretary.
Madam Secretary, I would like to discuss on the topic culture of our country, Myanmar. Myanmar has a deep culture of hospitality and openness. Most people who visit are struck by a warm and welcoming nature of the locals, who are often keen to ask questions and make friends. And the people love to enjoy themselves, whether it is taking part in one of the hundreds of festivals happen around the year. Although enjoying a game of football, everyone loves a boisterous public gathering to lift their spirits. Theravada Buddhism is the most widespread religion in Myanmar and plays a big role in public and private life. Most young people spend time in educational, monastic education, and monks and nuns of homes. There are hundreds of thousands hold a revered place in society. Religious monuments can also be found on many roads, river banks, and towns and villages throughout the country. There are central to the life towns of with shopping, aircrafts, and other businesses sometimes built in their entrance areas. Outside the main ethnic Burmese population areas, particularly in parts of Kachin, Karen, and Chin states, Christianity is devoutly observed. American missionaries played a large part in converting previously animist locals during late 19th and early 20th centuries, and elements of animism remain part of this culture. Islam and Hinduism are also practiced in Myanmar, particularly by ethnic Indians, and temples can be found around the country, most notably in Yangon. Tensions between members of these religions and the Buddhist mainstreams have sometimes surfaced, most notably with incidents of Buddhist-Muslim violence in recent years. Most have occurred in remote areas and foreigners have not been affected. Superstition is evident in Myanmar culture. Although it is often played down, some people consult astrologers about personal and business decisions. And it is said that location of a new capital, Naypyidaw, was decided on the advice of astrologers. In the 1980s, military dictator Nevin introduced 35 and 75 kyat banknotes because of his belief in special powers of numbers. Tradition clothing. Traditional clothing in Myanmar varies around the country, but a national staple is the longi, sarong, which is worn by both men and women. The longi was in fact introduced relatively recently in colonial times, but its popularity is rooted in its simplicity and suitability to such a hot climate. Thank you, Madam Secretary.
Madam Secretary, Myanmar is rich in minerals, including metal ores, petroleum, and natural gas, and also has significant deposits of precious and semi-precious stones. Although the production is generally increasing since the late 20th century. Trade. Madam Secretary, the government decisions in the early 1916 to the limit foreign trade reversed the export orientation of British colonial period. However, the subsequent relaxation of trade restrictions, notably the legalization of trade with Thailand and China, the late 20th century. Taxation. Business remaining in the private sector after nationalization account for only a small fraction of the country's tax income. The balance is collected from the public sector. Madam Secretary, transportation is as follows. The country's trade in rice is dependent on water transport. The Irrawaddy River is the backbone of Myanmar's transportation system. Thank you, Madam Secretary.
Any questions?
Mongolia and Zimbabwe? Mongolia, you can ask.
Do the people of Myanmar follow the superstitions in 21st century?
Yes, the people of our country still follow superstition in 21st century. It is said that many people take the consult astrologers for business and personal decisions. And it is also said that the location of our new capital, Naypyidaw, is also consulted by astrologers.
Zimbabwe, now you can ask.
Why it is said
that Irrawaddy River is the backbone of Myanmar?
As we know that rice crops need more water to grow, and our country's trade in rice is totally dependent on water transport. So it is said that Irrawaddy River is the backbone of my country.
Thank you, delegate from Myanmar. Next, Zimbabwe, you can begin now.
Good morning, honorable people on the chair. Respected Madam Secretary, we the delegates of Zimbabwe would like to speak about our country, its history, geography, culture, and issues faced by us. Our country, Zimbabwe, is known for its rich tradition of stone sculpture and for its natural tourist attractions, such as the Victoria Falls and the Great Zimbabwe Falls. Our country was a British colony known as Rhodesia from 1896 until 1980. Before the British arrived, the country was made up of a number of separate kingdoms. The earliest people to inhabit our country were the San, sometimes called as Khoisan. History of Zimbabwe. Until roughly 2000 years ago, Zimbabwe was populated by the ancestors of San people. Bantu inhabitants of the region arrived and developed ceramic production in the area. A series of trading empires emerged, including the Kingdom of Mpungubwe and the Kingdom of Zimbabwe. In 1880s, the British South Africa Company began its activities in the region, leading to the colonial era in southern Rhodesia. Following the Lancaster House Agreement of 1979, there was a transition to internationally recognized majority rule. In 1980, the British, more specifically the United Kingdom, ceremonially granted our country independence on 18th April that year. In 2000s, Zimbabwe's economy began to deteriorate due to various factors. Economic instability led a lot of Zimbabweans to move overseas or to the neighboring countries. Zimbabwe in 1980 had been known by several names such as Rhodesia, Southern Rhodesia, and Zimbabwe Rhodesia. Geography of Zimbabwe. Zimbabwe is a landlocked country in southern Africa lying wholly within the tropics. The country has borders with Botswana, Mozambique, South Africa, Zambia, and almost meets Namibia at its westernmost point. The capital and the largest city is Harare. A country of roughly 15 million people, Zimbabwe has 16 official languages, with English, Shona, and Nebele as the most common ones. Climate and terrain. The climate is markedly varied by altitude. Much of the country is on plateau, with a higher central plateau forming a watershed between the Zambezi and Limpopo rivers. Elevations range from below 2,000 feet in the river basins to over 7,000 feet in the eastern highlands. The climate on the central highlands is moderate in all the seasons, with warm days and cool nights. Zimbabwe has savanna-covered plateau, some 4,000 to 5,000 feet above the sea level. Zimbabwe covers 150,000 square miles. Latitudinal extent. Zimbabwe's latitude and longitude is 20 degrees 0 minutes south and 30 degrees 0 minutes east. Location. Zimbabwe, officially the Republic of Zimbabwe, is a landlocked country located in Southeast Africa. Zambezi forms a natural river and boundary with Zambia. The massive Victoria Falls on the river forms the world's largest curtain of falling water. Languages of Zimbabwe. Zimbabwe has 16 official languages, with English, Shona, and Nebele as the most common ones. The African population of Zimbabwe is made up of at least 10 ethnic groups, each speaking a different language. The two largest among them are the Shona and the Nebele. The Shona people make up about 60% of the population. They are well known for their skill in working with iron, copper, and gold. The Nebele people, recognized for their skill as military strategists before the arrival of British, make up about 20% of the population. Most of the people speak at least two different languages, including one of the three official languages of Zimbabwe, that is English, Shona, and Nebele. Thank you.
Madam Secretary, I would like to discuss the politics in our country. The politics in our country takes place in a framework of full presidential republic. Legislative power is invested in both the government and parliament. Elections in our country. Our country government consists of an elected head of state, the president, and the legislature. Presidential term lasts for 5 years and is elected by majority. A second round if no candidates receive majority in the first round. Madam Secretary, the leader of our country is Emmerson Dambudzo Mnangagwa. He was born on 15 September 1942. He is a Zambian revolutionary and politician who served as president in 2018. He secured his first full term as president in 2018, Zambian general elections. Economy of Zambia. Our economy mainly relies on its tertiary industry, which makes up to 60% of total GDP as of 2017. We have the second biggest informal economy, as the share of its economy, which has score of 60.6%. Agriculture and mining mainly contribute to exports. Our country has reserves of metallurgical chromite. Other critical minerals include coal, asbestos, copper, gold, platinum, and iron ore. In 2000, our country planned a land redistribution act to collect white-owned. Culture of Zimbabwe. We have many different cultures which may include beliefs and ceremonies. One of them being is Shona. Shona, the largest ethnic group in our country is Shona. Sports in Zimbabwe. Football is the most popular sport of our country, although rugby union, cricket, golf, tennis, and netball. Cricket is the second most popular sport of our country after football. Football. The Zambian national football team, nicknamed Warriors, have qualified for the African National Cup twice. Tribal communities of our country. Our country is a mixture of people. More than two-thirds of the people speak Shona as their first language. Shona-speaking people live in mostly eastern two-thirds of our country. Facts of Zimbabwe. Languages. The country with most official language in the world is Zimbabwe, with 16. It's a Guinness World Record. Victoria Falls, the world's largest waterfall. Victoria Falls is one of the original 7 natural wonders of the world. We love the flame lily. The flame lily is the national flower of the world and is listed as a protected plant under the Parks and Wildlife Acts. Large elephant populations. After Botswana, Zimbabwe has second largest elephant population in the world at more than 85,000. Thank you, Madam Secretary.
Madam Secretary, I would like to explain natural resources of our country. Our country has abundant natural resources, including diamond, gold, coal, iron ore, chromium ore, vanadium, asbestos, nickel, copper, lithium, tin, and platinum group metals. Is our country a resource-rich country? Our country boasts a long history of mining. The country is rich in natural resources with known occurrence over 40 minerals, primarily gold, nickel, and copper, but also diamonds, platinum, and chromite. Climate. Our country has subtropical climate that is influenced by its altitude. There are four distinct seasons. First, a warm wet season from November to March. A transitional season from April to May. Third, a cool dry winter season from May to August. And a warm dry season from August to October. Zimbabwe, lying north of Tropic of Capricorn, is completely within the tropics, but enjoys subtropical conditions because of its high average elevation. The high altitude of the broad plateaus of western Zimbabwe helps to guarantee fine weather there during the cool dry winter months from May to August. Water crisis. Our country is in the grip of national wide water crisis due to poor rains and drought. Most local authorities have been forced for rationing water. Bulawayo, 450 kilometers south of Harare, is facing the worst crisis. Wildlife. The large number of animals all year round, elephant, buffalo, sable, roan, giraffe, wild beast, impala, and even gemsbok, are followed by their predators, leopard, wild dog, and cheetah, along with African wild cat, serval, honey badger, civet, and spotted hyena. Thank you, Madam Secretary.
Madam Secretary, I would like to speak on the agriculture in our country. Agriculture plays an important role in our country. It is the backbone of our country's economy. Many of our people remain largely in villages and derive their livelihood by agriculture. Agriculture in our country is managed by the Ministry of Agriculture. The major crops grown in our country are maize, cotton, soybean, wheat, and tobacco. Maize is the staple food of our country. Tobacco is the important cash crop of our country in terms of generating foreign exchange and earning about $782 million and accounting around 9% of total exports in 2020. Religion. Madam Secretary, our country is a home to numerous religions. Christianity is the dominant religion in our country. It was introduced to us by the British missionaries in early 14th century. The estimated numbers on Muslims in our country are nearly 1,20,000. In 1995, there were about 16,200 Hindus in our country, which now reduced to only 3,000 Hindus. Lifestyle. Life in our country offers adventure, variety, diversity, and culture, and still having a relatively low cost. There are about 16 million people in our country and estimated 12 million people living abroad. In our country, there are likely to be more people living outside the country than in it. Films and entertainment. Madam Secretary, our country has an active film culture in its pre- and post-colonial periods. Economic crisis and political crisis have been features of this industry. Thank you, Madam Secretary. Madam Secretary, I would like to speak about pollution in my country. Air pollution is the fastest becoming problem for all developing countries, with our country having its own problem as a result. Water supply and sanitation in our country is defined by many small-scale successfully programmed, but also by generally lack of improved water and sanitation system in our country. According to the World Health Organization, in 2012, 80% of our country has access to improved clean drinking water sources and 40% of our country has access to improved sanitation facilities. Access to improved sanitation facility and water supply is distinctly less in rural areas. There are many factors which continue to determine the foreseeable future of water supply and sanitation in our country. Important cities.
Harare is the capital and the most populous city of our country. The city proper has an area of 960.6 km square and retained the name Salisbury until 1982, when it was renamed Harare on the second anniversary of our independence from United Kingdom. Long the commercial capital of our country, Harare has seen economic ups and downs since 2000. It remains an important center of commercial, government, finance, real estate, manufacturing, healthcare, design, art, culture, tourism, and religion affairs. Harare has hosted multiple international conferences and events, including the 1995 All African Games and 2003 Cricket World Cup. In 2018, Harare was ranked as the Grama World City. Thank you, Madam Secretary.
Any questions,
Mangalya and Manma? Mangalya, you can ask. Why did Rhodesia change its name to Zimbabwe?
As early as 1960, the African Political Organization said that the country should use the name Zimbabwe. They used this name in the titles for their organizations.
Manma, you can ask now.
Which is the most popular sport of Zimbabwe?
Most popular sport of our country is football. Our country represents the men's international football team and is controlled by the Zambian Association. We have the 8 main football stadiums to play football.
Thank you, delegates from Zimbabwe. Are there any motions on the floor?
Yes, Mr. Speaker. Motions for the agenda.
Mongolia, you have been recognized. What points do you raise from Mongolia?
To discuss about climate change and extinction of species, Mr. Speaker.
Granted to discuss delegates from Mongolia. Manma, what points do you raise?
Mr. Speaker, we raise the points about climate change and COVID-19 issue in Myanmar.
Granted to discuss delegates from Myanmar. Zimbabwe, what
point is raised? Yes, Mr. Speaker, to discuss about environmental issues, COVID-19 situation and vaccination.
Granted to
Madam Secretary, I would like to express my concern about extinction of animals in my country. The name Gobi is a Mongol term for a desert steppe, which usually refers to a category of arid rangeland with insufficient vegetation to support marmots but with enough to support camels. Mongols distinguish Gobi from desert proper, although the distinction is not always apparent to outsiders unfamiliar with the Mongolian landscapes. Madam Secretary, Gobi rangelands are fragile and easily destroyed by overgrazing, which results in expansion of a true desert. A stony waste where not even bacterial camels can survive. Now I would like to share a video about the extinction of animals in my country. Madam Secretary, I request the chair to take this issue into consideration. Thank you.
Madam Secretary, I would like to raise the concern about my country. Environmental problems faced by my country include desertification, inadequate water supply, and air pollution and water pollution. The presence of Gobi Desert in the southeastern part of the country and mountains in the northwest provide natural limits to the amount of agricultural land. My country is also vulnerable to the impacts of climate change, which threatens the country's water and food security and biodiversity, and air pollution and climate change. In my country, the following climate change impacts have been confirmed in each sector. According to the weather observation, an increase in temperature about of 2.14 degrees Celsius is confirmed between 1940 and 2008. Regarding rainfall, there is a tendency for precipitation in winter to decrease, with those in summer to increase are closely linked. So, Madam Secretary, I request the chair to take these issues into consideration. Thank you, Madam Secretary.
Thank you, delegate from Mongolia. Manma, you can speak now.
Like to
tell about my climate change.
Agriculture in Myanmar is extremely valuable to climate change. The predicted rise to temperature in Myanmar is expected to do major negative impacts on agricultural product and food security. Temperature increase of 2 to 4 Celsius will threaten agricultural productivity, stressing crops to reducing yields. Thank you, Madam Secretary.
Madam Secretary, COVID-19 issue in Myanmar. In Myanmar, from 3rd January 2020, 3:36 p.m. CEST to 20th September 2021, there have been 4,59,436 confirmed cases of COVID-19 with 17,583 deaths reported to WHO. As of 17th September 2021, a total of 90,1,616 vaccine doses have been administered. Thank you, Madam Secretary.
Thank you, Anna. Ms. Zimbabwe, you can share now.
I would like to raise concern about environmental issues in my country. Large part of our country were once covered by forest and abundant wildlife. Deforestation and poaching has decreased the amount of wildlife. Woodland degradation and deforestation due to population growth, urban expansion, lack of fuel are the major concern which diminish the amount of fertile soil. Local farmers are also being criticized for burning of vegetation to heat their tobacco vans. Thank you, Madam Secretary.
Madam Secretary, I would like to raise concern about COVID-19 situation and COVID vaccination. On 22nd February 2021, our country launched the National COVID-19 Vaccination Program by using BBIBP co-vaccination. As of 17th September 2021, 29,30,850 people have received their first dose and 20,32,831 people have received their second dose. The COVID-19 pandemic in our country is part of worldwide pandemic of coronavirus disease 2019.
caused by severe respiratory syndrome coronavirus 2. The COVID-19 pandemic was confirmed to have reached our country in March 2020. Some of our country's provinces, especially Manicaland, Maswingo, Mashonaland East, also struggled with a malaria outbreak at the same time. Thank you, Madam Secretary.
Thank you, Zimbabwe. Now, delegates can submit their points.
Congratulations to all the delegates for setting this amazing conference. As the Secretary of Madam United Nations, I declare this conference adjourned.
Now I request Mr. Yogesh Kale to propose vote of thanks.
Good morning to one and all present over here. Provincial Superior of Pune Province, Brother Jaiku, Education Convener, Reverend Brother Shazam Anthony, Principal Reverend Brother Dr. A. Anthony Levy of Montfort School, CBSC City, Vice Principal Brother Kumar Chandra, Brother Avinash, all the Montfortian brothers, my dear colleagues, participated delegates of various countries, dear parents, well-wishers, and all the viewers, and Mr. Yogesh standing before you to propose oath of thanks on the occasion of Moral United Nations conference organized by Montfort School CBSC City. Thanksgiving has been, and God and goes where it must go. Your prayer knows much more about it than you do. I extend my deep gratitude to God Almighty for all the blessings upon us to make this event successful. Gratitude is the best blossom which springs from the soul, and that make the happy both the giver and the receiver. We are deeply indebted of each personality and esteemed provincial superior of Pune Province, Brother Jacob, for his presence throughout the program. Thank you, brother. Thank you in a small world, because under your spiritual guidance, we experience God's love. We owe special gratitude to our education convener, Reverend Brother Shahjan Anthony, for his presence on the occasion and raising all of us. Thank you, brother. Thank you for your kind gesture. Saying it from my heart, you helped us right through from the start. Now that we have reached the way, we just have heartfelt thanks to say. We are extremely thankful to our beloved
visionary principal brother, Dr. A. Anthony Reddy of Montfort School, CBSE, for his continued guidance, support, encouragement to make the event fruitful. Thank you, brother. We are also deeply thank Vice Principal Mr. Kumar Chanda for his energetic and enthusiastic support. We are also thankful to Brother Avinash. Thanksgiving is a time of togetherness and gratitude. Heartfelt thanks all the non-Persian brothers for their collective concerns to the broader concerns of humanity and its welfare. Thank you all, brothers. I deeply thank all our non-Persian teachers for their guidance and help to prepare all the delegates of various countries, Ms. Saiba, Ms. Rosaline, and myself for taking efforts and preparing the students for today's events. We are also thankful to all our teachers for their support and commitments towards making the event gracious. We are especially thankful to non-teaching staff and people who have worked for technical arrangements, stage setting, which added carnival to the events. We are thankful to all the participated delegates who have taken a lot of efforts to learn, to understand, and to speak here and present their ideas, thoughts in this Model United Nations Conference first. My dear chants, I appreciate your effort and enthusiasm. I thank you. I thank all the parents for their support, presence, and encouragement to all of us. We express our deep gratitude to all the heroes of watching and motivating our delegates. Thank you. The Model United Nations Conference, first of Montfort School City, brings out the talent of every individual within themselves. We solicit your continuous support and encouragement to march forward in our peace for knowledge. Thank you. Have a great day. Thank you once again.